Welcome to the Princeton class of 1979's 42nd reunion. Hopefully the last time we'll be forced to gather for reunions virtually. We're thrilled to have you join us for Chronology is Your Friend, Writing Lives in History with David Michaelis and Alexander Wolff. I'm your moderator, Bruce Peterson. After about an hour, we'll start a Q&A. Please type your questions in using the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. David Michaelis is the author of several bestsellers, including N.C. Wyeth, which won the National Book Award for Biography, Schultz and Peanuts, a biography, a National Book Critics Circle Best Recommended Book, and most recently, Eleanor, a finalist for the 2020 L.A. Times Book Prize. He lives in Westchester County, New York, with his family. Before writing his latest book, End Papers, Alexander Wolff was the longest tenured writer at Sports Illustrated, leaving in 2016 after 36 years. He's the author of co-author of 8 books about basketball, including the New York Times bestseller, Raw Recruits, and Big Game Small World, which was named a New York Times notable book in 2020. As a Ferris Professor of Journalism, he taught a writing seminar at Princeton in 2020. Taken together, Eleanor and End Papers provide a terrific history of the 20th century, and as Alex recently communicated to David, thrilled to see our books not just overlap, but interlock. David and Alex, you have the floor, or in this case, the screen.
Thanks, Bruce.
Thank you, Bruce. Alex, hi. I've got to just say one thing, which is, I've only won one thing in my life, which was our class egotist award. And no one wants to remember that. And we can just move on. I've moved on. It took a long time, but I've moved on. But I didn't win the National Book Award. Bruce, that's so kind of you to award it to N.C. Wyeth. That happened to be something, a very obscure thing called the Ambassador Book Award for Biography given by the English Speaking Union years and years ago. So anyhow, just to correct
that. You should win some massive award for Eleanor, which I just finished. And
thank you.
I love the idea that our books interlock. I couldn't help but notice that the very time that Eleanor was living on Washington Square in the 40s, my grandfather and step-grandmother were living on Washington Square in the 40s.
Amazing.
Kind of wrestling with the same questions.
What number were they at?
They were
29.
Yeah, and wasn't Eleanor on Washington Square West?
Yes. Yep, in that big building in the West, yeah.
I think my ancestors were on Washington Square South, and two different buildings, but it sounds more glamorous than it was because they basically turned their living room and spare bedroom into a mail room and an editorial office, even as they were living and cooking and all amidst it. So I think Eleanor had a slightly more comfortable existence.
Well, there's so many ways to frame our conversation today, but one thing I wanted to throw out right away because it piggybacked on one great comment you made about the spring of 77 when you were talking with Rob back a month or two ago. And it's one of my key memories, and it's so mirrored when you talk about our books interlocking. Alex and I were both in Humanities 406. Bob Massey taught it the spring of 77 when we were both sophomores and managed to work our way into the class, and which was filled with seniors, some of whom had taken the course with McPhee already and some of whom were just, you know, pretty solidly farther along. I think we were both among the sort of newcomers to the world of writing prose this way. But you had triggered a memory for me, which was really, and into this day, Bob Massey and the moments of sitting, going line by line, comma by comma, period by period, were the key for me. But really the big thing, the thrill, the excitement, the electricity came from this moment every week. We would all be assigned our different, we have our different, or we have the same topic or whatever, but our different pieces would have been submitted to a box. And that box was in Firestone, as I recall it, somewhere maybe on B floor or somewhere. But I remember the thrill of going to that box and picking out my sheaf of copied essays and pieces and pieces of writing that my contemporaries, and here was, you know, this Alex Wolff was writing about the way Converse, you know, All-Stars felt, the Cadillacs of the feet. And I remember the thrill was the thrill of learning from your contemporary and seeing that they were had developed a little farther along or they were doing this. And I felt this year when I saw End Papers, and there's a number of reasons for me professionally, emotionally, and otherwise that I responded to your book, but it was the same thrill of here's my exact contemporary and he's put this in the box and I'm going to get it. And I'm going to see what he did with this because this is a staggering and astonishing thing he's done. And I guess one of the things I wanted to ask you to maybe frame a bunch of our conversation here at the beginning was, so we both have sort of similar experiences in one way that we were off in the worlds, you much more than I, in the worlds of formal journalism. I was a freelancer always, you were at Sports Illustrated, and I left earlier after Manhattan Inc. Days than obviously you were much more of a career guy than I in journalism. But the same experience I think you experienced with this book that I did, which was suddenly you're confronting not a piece of writing that's about the present really, but it's about the past and about not just the past really, but it's also, and in my case with Eleanor, much more than in my earlier books, it's about a figure in history, in world history, and world history is going on. And I just kind of wanted to ask you, like, what was it like for you when that, like you lost the altitude, not just of corporate journalism or being on the 25th floor or all that stuff, but what was it like when you were suddenly in the world of history? Was it a shock? Did you feel like, wow, I really always felt like I wanted to be here. I can tell the truth. And, you know, I mean, your book is a book about books. It's a book about family. But it's primarily as you beautifully limb in the epigraph, it's a book about not knowing things really yet about your family and then asking those questions and then confronting the truth of what you find, of what you found. And I kind of wanted to ask you about all that, about what it's like to suddenly be in the world of Berlin, archives, history, searching through tender and difficult things. What was it, you know, was it a shock? Did you freak out? Was it strange waking at 4 a.m. in Berlin with your family around you thinking, what am I doing here?
Well, it's funny. There's an image in your book. I think it was in the acknowledgments of kind of blowing, being a fire starter and blowing on paper that you've gathered, tinder. And there's a little bit of that. I mean, I should say that I try to cop this pose of being a miscast sports writer on this project. And it's a little misleading because I ended up doing a lot of historical pieces for Sports Illustrated over the years. By the end, you know, I'd been there 25 and more years. I think the conversations among editors might've gone something like, oh, let's ask Wolf to do it. He probably witnessed these events in real time. So I would get assigned these things. And I quickly learned the beauty of the local historical society or, you know, chatting up an archivist. I mean, your acknowledgments basically think for 4 pages, you think archivists.
Yes.
I guess I was a history major. I don't think it's an accident we had Bob Massey, you know, that the stars lined up, that we had this guy whose entire career was making a narrative out of history, you know, sort of doing what you did. Listeners should know that when David launches into Eleanor, he's at the Roosevelt Library and he's looking at, you know, millions of documents and boxes, and he has to be kind of talked down from his hyperventilation on the ledge. And don't worry, you don't need to pour through every single one. You need to just sort of distill it. And I think the more circumscribed it is, the more you get your brief as being one that you can manage, the less intimidating it is. You know, I kind of had this centrifugal force of my family, and it was pulling in all these things orbiting my family, historical things. And you're absolutely right, though. It was a work of history. Yeah, it's kind of a memoir. There are these flights of journalism in it.
Yep.
But Grove Atlantic, the publisher, was emphatic from the beginning that this was not a memoir, that this was going to get classified as a work of history. And in many ways, I think that was very liberating. It helped clarify for me that this was sort of the main thread, that I could tell the lives of my dad and my grandfather. I could tell the story of me discovering all this stuff. But if I could background it with history, and Lord knows it was gripping stuff. And a lot of it I was absorbing on the fly. I mean, for any book like the ones that we've recently written, you're doing amazing amounts of auxiliary reading that's just enriching your appreciation for the texture of the times. And you're not necessarily, you know, it's a select bibliography. You're not going to pull every single one of those sources into it. So yeah. I think the biggest concern I had was I was operating in a foreign language, really. I mean, I'd taken a few semesters of German in college and stopped out for a year and went to Switzerland, where they don't even really speak proper German. So I was thinking my way through it, but I did know enough German to be able to identify a document and say, oh, I want to drill down into that. Wow. You know, if you see a document that has your dad's favorite uncle's name on it and it ends with Heil Hitler, you want to look at it a little more closely. Wow. So there was that. And really, I think the world of archivists, I know you can amen this. There are people who go to work every morning hoping someone like you or me will show up so they can take us by the hand.
Yeah.
And they really know where the bodies are buried. So there was some of that. So my question for you on a long list, really if you were to read David's book as you would a novel, the fog would figure very prominently in it. It's in the very first sentence. There's a break in the clouds in the final paragraph, but. Yeah. There were so many episodes in Eleanor Roosevelt's life that hung on the fate of fog, either fog lifting, fog coming in on little cat's feet, whatever they are. Yes. You would never have stooped to such a low cliche. But I wondered in the process of what, a decade of putting this book together, was there a moment where fog said, you know, sort of the lights blinked through the fog at you and said, yes, this is a leitmotif in this woman's life.
You mean the fog itself? Because yeah. I tell you, the thing is actually, as you were saying that, I just had a realization as just right now, which is really what, in a funny way, one of the reasons I focused on the fog was because I was lost in it. Meaning Eleanor to me in the very beginning and for years, I mean, we're talking about a 10-year project here. Amazing. I mean, that's a luxury and I'll admit it right off the bat. 10 years on something is, for me, my first books were 6 and 8 years, but this was a luxury and a lot of life happened and things happened. So it had to be 10 in the end. But one of the reasons it was 10 was because for 3 years, Eleanor was like a mountain in a fog. I would walk out every day and all I would see was fog. And some days it would mysteriously, you know, part and I'd see a little closer. And it was so frustrating to me because it took me a long time to get to know her and really a long time to get to know her. And even one of my very beginning, you know, everybody, there's good publishing reasons when you get into a project. In this case, there was no one volume biography for years. So there was always all good reasons. And Alice Mayhew at Simon & Schuster was excited about the book. And I was thrilled to be working with her for the first time. So publishing, you know, has its own momentums, but you get back into this garage where I am now and then the fog descends and you wake up each morning, what am I doing here? And there was one day where I had to go down to Washington to finally clear out a safe deposit box from years earlier at Riggs Bank, because Riggs was closing. It's the Gold Dome one down on M Street in Wisconsin. And you know, this was my late mother's, she died years and years ago. And this was finally the final moment of getting this out. But there were some of her papers. And my mother had worked with Eleanor Roosevelt. When I was a child, she was a producer on the program that Eleanor was on at WGBH, which was then the public television station in Boston, but it was broadcast on NET, National Education Television, and it was earlier even than another tall woman with a fluty voice, you know, before Julia Child, it was that early in public television. And so it was a very primitive and rudimentary type operation, and my mother got very close to Mrs. Roosevelt doing it, and she described a lot of their daily interactions in something I found in the safe deposit box, which was a piece of, my mother started novels, she started plays, she started biography, she started every memoirs especially, and they were always on sheets of yellow paper. And sometimes they would go on. And this one, I was fascinated because it was pretty down close to the bottom. And so I'd been there a long time and suddenly my eyes lit on and went, oh my God, this is about Eleanor. And she started talking about how complicated it was for her to wake Mrs. Roosevelt up from a nap. It was her job when Eleanor would have these power naps to kind of put her hand on Mrs. Roosevelt's shoulder. And she described this sort of mana, this sort of energy that would come off Mrs. Roosevelt from these moments where, and she wouldn't know whether she should do it or whether she should let her sleep. Anyway, and she, and people didn't know this about her. And the real secret was, yeah, mom, yeah, what? That was it. That was all she wrote. And so there were moments like that where I'd walk out the way a journalist does after you've had an amazing interview, where without even knowing it, you realize, oh my gosh, yes, I'm here on earth to tell this story. I don't have it yet, but I got the feeling. I've got the fire in the belly to tell this story, and there's something here for me to complete. And there's big circles, big wheels are turning kind of feeling I had after that, and came back to more fog and more. And it was years before. And one of the things, oddly enough, you've probably just noticed me saying this sort of now very, well, in our generation, actually, it wasn't too odd because one of the leading editors of the day was Mr. Sean. And so Mrs. Roosevelt was not such an odd construction for me just to be using. But really, honestly, what happened to my book, I had two things that happened that made it happen the way you just were asking about. One was I finally stopped calling her Mrs. Roosevelt. And one of my recognitions was that she was asking for love all her life in different ways and seeking it. And several of the men who she drew close to in her life, one of them was Joe Lash, who ended up being her biographer. And I looked at his biography now in a whole new light, just because I was now learning more and more and more about their relationship, their personal relationship. But also especially this very strange relationship she had at the end of her life with her doctor, in which it almost became a kind of emotional torture that she would ask this younger man who was 18 years younger to please call her Eleanor. She begged him. I mean, she would say, it will make such a difference for me. And he couldn't do it. And so I suddenly realized that I too was another one of these men who in her life had been sort of Mrs. Roosevelting her, because I still had her on a pedestal in a way in my emotional life. And it wasn't until I finally figured out she's Eleanor that I began having a new relationship with her. And partly that is another part of this conversation, but it was really 2015 and 2016 and the Trump era that changed my relationship to the book. The politics that began to happen, the world of American fascism, the world of authoritarianism that was worldwide, that you were seeing in Berlin, and Berlin as a great defender, and Berlin as Germany ironically was opening up to immigrants and giving asylum, as we were closing our borders, as we were freaking out on the border, all these things as we were doing, as the Trump administration was issuing orders to the border, unlike anything since actually FDR's internment of the Japanese, all these things brought this to life in a way that I had not expected. More on that, but one of the things that moved me in your book in just this way is the moment where you were going through your father, Nico's letters from the front as he was serving in the Wehrmacht, especially on the Russian front, and realizing how well-fed he and his fellow troops were, as you were in your research discovering about the borderlands and Timothy Snyder and about the plan, the hunger plan, the deliberate plan on the part of the Nazis to systematically starve Russians, peasants, Polish and Russian villages. And I just thought that was such a great, both it came alive for me in so many ways, but it brought alive the role of two narratives, where you're laying things down, in chronologies, and things are beginning to pop up in ways you hadn't expected.
Yeah, I mean, you talked about luxury and the luxuries that time affords you, and I had that ability to read the personal alongside the sort of great sweep, you know, Timothy Snyder, the great sweep of history, and then my dad's letters, you know, granularly describing how well they're eating. And then of course allows me to go back and recall a conversation I had with my dad where he talked about a Ukrainian woman that he hung out with when he was posted for a year and a half in this one city, Dniepropetrovsk, and how he had given food. They'd go for picnics together and had given food to her family.
Wow.
And suddenly a frame gets put around that story that my dad didn't share with me. So I've got to ask you, had you ever heard of the Hunger Plan? That just hit me like a ton of bricks. I mean, I was a history major. I thought I understood this stuff. I knew about camps in the woods in Poland and gas, but I didn't know about this. And I felt a little sheepish acknowledging that, but that was one of just again and again and again, a revelation that I could set alongside something really personal.
Yeah.
The personal stuff, some of it didn't come in letters. Some of it came in conversations I'd had with particularly an aunt Maria, who's a real character in the book. It's so interesting how we were both engaged with female characters as much as we were. Now, my book is a little bit of a misdirection because it's got this patrilineal spine to it. Grandfather, father, and me telling the story. But if you read it, yeah, there's this Greek chorus of female voices. My grandmother, my step-grandmother, my aunt, who are commenting. And it's funny, I think I mentioned this to Rob when he and I talked, just how that was a way when I was an SI writer to kind of unlock the male athlete. You would go to the women around him who didn't feel that need that the professional male athlete so often has to show invulnerability.
Right.
And you're crying out for access to some detail that humanizes, that helps convey tribulation that surely they went through to rise. Because at Sports Illustrated, I would be dealing with people who were at the height of their powers, or definitionally, because we wouldn't be doing a story on somebody who's batting 185, you know?
Right, right.
So that was one of the things that just kind of fell into place. But in reading Eleanor, I thought the woman to woman relationships, and I'm saying well beyond ones that were romantic, and even the way you deployed her voice, you know, frequently from her columns, sometimes from her diaries, there was this pattern to her voice and to her sentiments, where there would always be this kind of self-deprecating or minimizing sentence or half sentence at the end. So you'd say something sweeping about where we are as a society, where the world is, human nature, just a, you know, a flash of really brilliant insight. And then, but I suppose that. You could see her just trapped between this huge intelligence, this electric connectivity with other people. You know, she should have been the president. On the other hand, she's completely observant of her role in that world into which she was born, whether it was a class thing, or whether it was just to the place of women in society thing. Yeah. And I think that's one of the reasons there's such a fabulous tension in your book.
Yeah. By the way, about not knowing things in history, one strange thing from the Princeton History Department that came in handy was Nancy Weiss Malkiel, who the wonderful, I mean, I don't want to call her a female professor, but since we're talking about women, the fact that she was a woman in the Princeton professoriate was, I think, a big deal in some ways. But she taught a Cold War course that certainly informed me. But I then discovered her work, and I discovered her work in Tammany Hall, groundbreaking work on Tammany Hall, groundbreaking work on the Republican Party, and on how African Americans left the Republican Party and came to the Democrats because of Eleanor Roosevelt. And I just was thrilled, actually, to discover this. You know, I mean, you know, Professor Malkiel, Professor Weiss, I mean, I just, that was a great thing to me. And in the world of laying down timelines, in the world of chronology, which I really was struck by your talking about it in that way to your students, saying chronology is your friend, because to me, the great gift that you get with history, the great gift you get, and journalism somewhat leaves you to your own devices on this, but when we were in Humanities 406 and the literature fact class, I, of course, being schematic and visual, loved McPhee's, and John McPhee, who of course taught the course, teaches the course, made the course the legendary thing it is over time. He was a visitor in our course, and a typical tradition at the time was for the current professor, Massey in our case, he brought in Bob Gottlieb, he brought in Carl Bernstein, he brought in John McPhee. And I remember McPhee's backward E to describe where the bear appeared in the river, so forth and so on. All those little things, and they're now, thank heavens, they're now in McPhee's various, you know, in draft four and various other things, that so students can actually read them and not have to be in, get their way in, you know, get into HUM 406. But I found that what, and I did that for years to imitate McPhee. I did things like I put, you know, cards up on bulletin boards and moved darts along. And I, you know, I was trying to imitate the master and figure out these incredibly intense visuals that would help me understand my story. Actually, what it ended up being for me, the real magic ended up being laying, I could show you here, probably up there is a thing on my bulletin board. And one side of it is every year in Eleanor's life. And then next to it is the age at which she was at in that year. And there are other, and then there's another line in it that is the things that are happening to her. And then next to that becomes various different history things that I tack up. But yeah, having the spine, someone's life is someone's life. And when you are the age we are, and, you know, God bless us, I mean, for being this age, because it's the one thing that's good about it is that you now see that, yeah, at 28, you are learning, you know, there's things that happen at 28 that don't happen at 48. There are things at 48. And so once you begin actually getting to the point where a lot of those years start to make sense to you as developmental milestones in a way, you can start seeing that actually laying things out that way teaches you a lot. And for me, even at the beginning, just to find out, well, I mean, in Eleanor's case, for instance, I had long heard, as one did in the 90s, that Eleanor Roosevelt was gay. We now learned, oh, so Eleanor's gay. And I remember when I began my book, the thing, I don't know what the function is called, but if you Google, is Eleanor Roosevelt, it'll show you the next most asked word, you know, is Eleanor Roosevelt. And when I began in 2009, it was gay. Is Eleanor Roosevelt gay? You know, does George Washington have wooden teeth? And so is Eleanor Roosevelt gay? And people would say, I remember once seeing the poet Sandy McClatchy at a book thing very early on, like 2010. And he said, oh, how are you following up with Schultz? Because his husband Chip Kidd had done the jacket for a beautiful dust jacket, a classic Chip Kidd work of art for after some struggle for my Schultz biography. So I saw Sandy McClatchy at a Chip Kidd book party thing. And he said to me, so what are you following up with? I said, well, Eleanor Roosevelt. And he said, Eleanor Roosevelt? I mean, what have you got there? I guess you have her sex life. And I said, well, do I, Sandy? I mean, what do you even mean by that? And I was sort of shocked, but it was the thing that people always ask me, is she gay? And the thing that was interesting about it was that I tried very hard to go into it, not with an open mind or a blank, that'd be absurd, given all of the experience one has with things and people in life. But I did try to let the chronology lay it out as a chronological, you know, a machine, so I could see where things happened in her life and who was influencing who. Well, the most important thing that happened, or the most amazing moment to me, was being in the middle of the letters of Lorena Hickok and Eleanor Roosevelt at the FDR Library. And they were actually Xerox copies in another collection, like in maybe even in Anna Rose. Well, no, anyway, I guess they were in the Lorena Hickok papers. Anyway, the point being, I'm reading them very carefully. I'm doing this very granular thing of typing out each paragraph that makes sense. And by the way, I think that was the year, I'm almost positive, that I started getting really spooked when every day at a certain time, the same time every day, in would come five guys, always guys, with the same ripped t-shirts, cargo shorts, and flip-flops. And they'd come flip-flopping into the FDR reading room. We were no longer in the Arthur M. Schlesinger research room because of the renovation. We were now in this much larger thing. So you'd hear the flip-flop, 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 flip-flop. And they'd all go over to these desks where big digital machines were ready for them. And they would sort of hoover up all these documents that I was, you know, doing this very granular old fashioned way. And I started thinking, who are those guys? You know, it was like Butch Cassidy, who are they? Because it was the same posse. They always flip-flopped in. They always flipped up out together for lunch. And usually the FDR reading room is one high school kid, you, somebody who's been there forever and will tell you a lot, and the wonderful staff, and the other person who's writing an Eleanor Roosevelt something, who sort of throws dagger eyes at you for about 2 weeks until you make friends. So that was the same. but never were five guys in flip-flops and cargo jeans, as if they detoured from a P-raid, you know, they were that much in uniform. Anyway, long story short, those were Ken Burns' guys. That's how Ken Burns gets his digital information, sends out teams, and they're doing all that. All those beautiful images are just getting sucked up into the digital maw. So anyway, I'm going over the letters granularly. I'm beginning to feel what anybody, I think, from our generation would feel, which is, oh, please, because there was all these big scholars talking about how this is how Victorian women talk to each other. These weren't gay. This wasn't about gayness or lesbians. This was about, you know, language and different. And she had spoken to her mother the same, her mother-in-law the same way. And yes, she did, but that's not the reason why. Anyway, here are two people who are literally falling in love. There's so much energy. There's so much heat. They're talking about different parts of their body that they are remembering after being together. They're longing for each other. There's all this. If you've ever been in love, you're going to remember these dazzling moments of that you see in the letters. And weirdly enough, at the time, the J. Edgar Hoover, you know, mythos was using these letters in the Leonard DiCaprio movie. These were letters were being quoted by J. Edgar Hoover and his lover and you know, Clyde Tolson, not really his lover, but his whatever. They weren't even acknowledged lovers, but it was sort of the leitmotif of love in the J. Edgar Hoover. So I'm in this very carefully, and I'm thinking the weirdest part of this is A, that it doesn't happen anywhere else in this room. There's no other collection that you're going to get this feeling from. There's no other evidence of Eleanor at this point in your life. But what then happens on my timeline of history is that the Depression is happening. The FDR is just about to become a candidate for president. And then very shortly, Eleanor is very, and Lorena Hickok is covering the campaign. All these other things are happening. But what happens is the moment they come into the White House, Eleanor does not have a job. Franklin did not allow her to have a job in his administration. She was far more politically advanced at that point than almost anyone else on the campaign. She had been the chairman of the women's division of the Democratic Party. She had run Al Smith's campaign from the women's side. She had done all kinds of major things that put her in the big leagues of politics. Even if it was the women's side, that didn't matter. She had developed judgment. She had developed independence, independent thinking. At any rate, long story short, as they came into the White House, Eleanor had no portfolio outside of the typical mistress of the White House kind of stuff. And Franklin, you know, was seen going into the White House literally on the day itself of inauguration, you know, on his mother's arm, with his mother at his arm. It was not these two. And we think of first ladies now who, you know, who develop one thing, one cause. You know, Mrs. Bush had Laura Bush, who I like very much. She had literacy. And of course, Michelle Obama, a great hero of mine, who had, you know, nutrition. But Eleanor, you know, wasn't like that. She was a holistic, first of all, she was holistic in her interest. She was a holistic healer, if she was anything, of the nation itself. It became gradual what she did do over 12 years and stunning and far-reaching and changing. But to see her at the moment of entering the White House, going upstairs with Lorena Hickok to give Lorena Hickok an exclusive from her new bedroom, and there's not enough privacy in the bedroom, they have to go into the bathroom. And they go into the bathroom and the staff is already beginning to talk about, we've never had a first lady go into a bathroom to do an interview, let alone, I mean, no first lady had ever given an interview from the White House on the first day in the White House, but to go into the bathroom with her, and why are they in there? And what are they doing? And this just doesn't happen. All these different things. And then that night, you know, she's looking at the ring on her finger, and it's from Lorena, and it's what's gotten her through the day. And she gives the picture that she always kept of the one person who was the closest to her at that point in her life, which was Lorena Hickok right next to her. And she gives that picture a kiss, a ritualistic kiss goodnight. And that's the first night in the White House for one of the most legendary and, you know, radically different first ladies. And you begin to see them conducting this love as the first 100 days. And it's the first 100 days of love, really, as much as it is of saving the nation and so forth and so on. So it's that, it's just like seeing that the intimacy of seeing your father talking about food and the starvation going on, the deliberate, strange Nazi world that's surrounding him. you know, and I guess that's the thing that is so electrifying to me about chronology and about the mechanics of this, is that a true unexpected truths arise from the steady granular study of something that I don't think that hoovering thing actually, the digital hoovering, you know, God bless Ken Burns and his images, but I think it really is this thing that we learned early from our life in the stacks and our life in you know, in libraries and in words and books and on the page, is that it that slow steady thing of every day of studying something and looking at something is a huge gift to this work.
Yeah, and it's really clarifying. I mean, I had my moment where the two chronologies kind of sat cheek by jowl, and I kind of gasped. Was there's a moment where my step grandmother, having made it safely to the U.S. and they're starting up Pantheon Books in the safety of Manhattan, Pearl Harbor has just happened, so the U.S. is in the war. She writes a letter to the countess in southern, now Vichy-occupied France, who had harbored her before she got out. Basically talks about how much she has loved America since the war began, because this great American can-do spirit is being deployed on behalf of defeating the Nazis. And I realize, I look at the date of the letter, and I realize as she's writing that letter, her stepson, my father, is on the Russian front. My aunt is about to be bombed out of her apartment in Freiburg, Germany, and her husband's first wife, on whom she was very good terms, was in Munich, which was about to be bombed to smithereens. So there is nothing like laying, I mean, it's on your bulletin board, David, but it just laying them out. And
So
all of this collecting that we both did, and my book clocked in at about 100,000 words. That's what I was told, the kind of classic nonfiction narrative, 100,000 words.
Yeah.
And I was pleased that I hit my mark pretty well. But to get there, there was an attrition process. Some of it I performed, some of it first readers performed, terrific editor performed. As you spent your 10 years collecting, processing, drafting, but tell me a little bit about how big was it before you wrestled it down to what it is? What was that all like? Who are the people who rode to your rescue?
Well, there was two, I never used research assistants before, and that's another thing about getting to be our age. It actually feels a lot less weird to have somebody who's a young person in the world of research going out for you to do. Well, let me start frame that around this. The thing that I was not expecting was that, having signed up to write Untitled Biography of Eleanor Roosevelt, I had sort of pretended to myself, and there's all kinds of things we always do, I think, at the beginning. One of them is, it's going to be shorter this time. Ha, ha, ha. You know, I'm not going to write a long first draft this time, honey. You know, it won't take me 10 years. We will go on a vacation someday. But it was more that I really believe this. I can't believe I believe this, that I wasn't really going to ever have to go into the archives and study Franklin Roosevelt. I would read about him. I would read biographies of him, you know, nonstop, but I just wouldn't be researching Franklin. I felt the same way about Theodore Roosevelt. I thought, this is about Eleanor. It's not about Uncle Ted. But you know, once you start, you get in. And one of the things that was unexpected was the archives at the Houghton Library at Harvard, which is the Theodore Roosevelt collection. It contains the secrets, if there are, if you can call them such, of Eleanor's father's family, of what she was really coming from and coming out of. And I, unfortunately, and it was partly because Barack Obama was president and this 2015, 2016 awakening in my own life had not yet happened. And I was focused on this one, and my son was in drug and alcohol treatment, which also brought me into this. But I was very acutely aware that the story of Eleanor's father, his alcoholism, his addiction, his decline, his death, his unbelievable just weakness toward her and his seduction of her and so many things that were, and there was rumors of, you know, maybe he had abused her sexually, maybe this, maybe that. I was determined to find the answer. And I found something stunning, and it was a sort of typical thing, which was one day I literally just read from the Harvard collection. Once I was home, I had Xerox things there. And there were one of the master archivists there who had led me by the hand, and I give an amen for that, because I had been led by the hand into certain areas. I brought back some of my copies. I was reading a little known unpublished memoir of Bammy Roosevelt, Eleanor's beloved, revered aunt, Theodore Roosevelt's sister, Elliot Roosevelt's sister, saying, oh yes, father. And the Roosevelts, who had come to Manhattan in the 17th century, did still have, in Eleanor's grandfather's day, a Maiden Lane hardware store. And it was just before they made the big break to uptown and becoming investment bankers and investing in ATT and ITT and the new world of telecommunications. And their grandfather actually missed the day when this guy came in and said, this new invention, this wood thing I have, it's called a telephone. Do you want to invest? And old, you know, Theodore Roosevelt Sr. said no. And life would have been, the whole story would have been different, actually, had he said yes. But so they were still in a, Theodore Roosevelt Sr., a great, one of the great philanthropists of New York City ever, who was caught up in doing all the good things for prisoners and for the insane and in hospitals and at the Museum of Natural History. And he was founding, he was the founder of a hospital, all these different things he did. He was still going down to work with his brothers at Roosevelt and Son. And he was still bringing home, according to this oral history, quantities of mercury. You remember playing with mercury?
Yeah.
Well, they literally, he was really literally, because guess what? They had gone into mirror making. It was this huge thing in the turn of the century and into 1905. It was up till 1905, but mirrors were made from like 18, it was about 1887 to 1907, that era. Huge thing in America for mirror making. We stopped using European mirrors. American glass was a big thing. Anyway, long story short, I suddenly looked at the thing and realized, oh my God, not only were they making mercury, but then as I was then going very carefully through the Roosevelt papers in the library, I realized they were using mercury medicines. And very long story short, I had eureka moment after eureka moment where I realized that their mother, that is Theodore Roosevelt's mother, was a Southern woman, Mittie Bullock. And I was stunned that McCullough hadn't found this. And I was stunned that Edmund Morris hadn't found this. But that very similar to Southern women of her generation, especially those in the North, they used, it's called blue pills, calomel. It was a mercury-based medication that we would use today, sort of like Adderall, sort of like, I don't know, it was like a pick-me-up also. It was like a way to focus. It was a way to flush your system and become suddenly very alert and active again. And if, you know, if you'd been lying down with the vapors for days, you suddenly, you took a dose of calomel and you were up and at it again. And you were, you know, and so she would literally dose her kids, and they were showing signs, all the signs that you see in Alice in Wonderland with the Mad Hatter. And, you know, the Hatters use mercury. Mercury is the Mad Hatter's disease. People die almost instantly in mercury, in real mercury mines and in mercury businesses. And the Roosevelt kids were being poisoned, and they were literally being poisoned in a way that I found stunning. And so I got all caught up as a journalist, in a sense, almost more than a history or a sort of journalist, historical journalist, in this idea that here was the reason that Elliot Roosevelt had become a self-medicating guy. And here was the reason for his seizure at St. Paul's School at age 12. And here was why he was having cognitive failures. And here's why Theodore Roosevelt had this shyness and all these different symptoms. I was matching symptoms with letters. I mean, I was down to this granular level, and I gave 300 pages to Alice Mayhew, and she said, this is interesting. I wonder why David McCullough missed this. And I wonder why wait a minute. And it was like Mr. Magoo was my editor. She said, wait a minute, are you writing Eleanor Roosevelt's biography?
And there go 300 pages.
And there went 300 pages. And, yeah. And so it was that got me back to basics and brought me back to reality. And then, you know, there was a sense also that I could not fathom. And that really began the real book. I couldn't fathom what it would be like to go, as I was going to have to, and I always knew I would. How would I go from the Victorian age to the atomic age in this book? How could I ever lead a reader through World War I, and then the 20s, and then the Depression, and then World War II, and then, we haven't even begun. I mean, the thing, the big difference for me, and this is, I'll shut up after I say this, but the other big thing, in addition to, oh yes, you have to study FDR. Oh yes, you have to study Theodore Roosevelt. Oh yes, you have to learn 20th century history, was that both of my previous subjects were men of a certain, I mean, N.C. Wyeth was an earlier generation. In fact, he's exactly the same age as FDR, same dates as FDR. And Schultz was somewhat later. But they were men whose lives were about creating a certain thing in an unrecognized art. And so as Peanuts, you know, became big, and it all sort of tapered off. And same with Wyeth. I mean, Wyeth was, as the illustrations, you know, Treasure Island, Robin Hood, all, you know, became cumulatively big, he then tapered. And men, I think, it's like Majode in Grapes of Wrath. Like, women just keep on going. You know, there's a flow with women. Men have these starts and stuff. But one thing both of those lives did was they really nicely tapered off toward the end. Eleanor, 47, and life's just starting.
Yeah.
And everything kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And if the war wasn't big enough, guess what? The Cold War was even bigger in a way for her.
Well, and just circling right back to Chronology, not only do you get the reader from Victorian age to Atomic age, but Eleanor is there on every day. And literally she is, talk about journalism. She's writing My Day. She wrote this 800 word column every day of her life, save what, 4 or 5 days right after her husband died.
Yeah.
I mean, the metabolism somebody has to be able to do that, that might have been, you and I can appreciate that on a level that most people can't.
Well, and also the flip side of it, which is big, I don't know, I'm not going to put you in this category, but I am definitely Germanic in one way. I always kid about this, about being thorough, because actually one of Betsy Wyeth, who was someone I met during the N.C. Wyeth book, and it was a big part of my finally starting that, said to me something like, well, you look pretty thorough. I said, oh, really? It shows? And so I am pretty thorough. And it's the one thing that I sometimes think I can bring to this, is a sort of thoroughness. And yet, guess what? I never left this room one single day in those years I was working on Eleanor where I thought I did my job today. Because there was always more.
Yeah.
There was always 20 more letters she'd written that I hadn't read. There was always 20 more people who she was now going to be in contact with. It, I could go down those rabbit holes one by one in the internet, but why? It was it was insane. It was crazy making, actually.
So how do you talk yourself into calling the moment? You know, just saying, yeah, that this, I have to call it here to do my one volume biography.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I mean, does it get easier to do that? Now you've done three of these.
Honestly, I found with her sometimes, I found that exhaustion actually worked on her in a way. And I did it the reverse. In other words, she was like a doctor or a nurse at the front for whom exhaustion just drives her on. For me, it was the other way. I would get exhausted and I would use the exhaustion. And I literally was pulling all-nighters as if I was in my Carol and B floor, literally trying to finish the thesis. Because Alice Mayhew was aging, although we didn't talk about that, but I could tell that for the first time an editor was asking me to produce chapters and say, look, I need chapter 11. And you fudged on this and you got to tell me, is it going to be on my desk on July 30th? And I'd say, okay, Alice, it will be. So I suddenly had all these mini deadlines to meet these chapter deadlines. And I would use these all nighters and I would finally get to the, you know, to 5 or 6 in the morning. I knew it was about to, get light out. And then I just didn't have any more time on this. And I'd say, just pick. What in this moment of nakedness, stripped down to lath and nails here yourself, because they were exhausting nights. And I'd say, what do you think matters? Because it was the only way I could finally decide. If I use my thinking brain, like my 10 a.m. Germanic thorough brain, forget it. It was always, I had to strip away and get kind of intuitive and almost unconscious in a way to make a final about what was really her. And it was the way I finally tuned into her. These all-nighters was a way of kind of feeling like it was just she and me. We were the only people in the world, kind of thing. I don't mean that sounds like I'm having some kind of need to have some kind of special relationship or something. It's not that. It was just, it was the only way I could actually finally block out the horror that was going on in America at the time, even though I was also feeding off that, because it meant that everything Eleanor had fought for to save democracy, to convince people everywhere that democracy mattered and that it wasn't a matter. I mean, all of Eleanor's themes in the beautifully written prose of My Day were the themes that you want to tell people today. You must vote. It's not guaranteed that we're going to have another election. You know, that's not a guarantee. We need to support this, et cetera, et cetera. So yeah. those things of being overwhelmed by her, by the kind of the mass of things and the time and the age and moving through time, was so overwhelming that I could only do it that way. But I also felt, by the way, and it was another thing that made being our age, and I keep harping on this because I think it's one of the things that comes up in a reunion's time. You think more about how old you are and how things are different now. But I do feel like there's no way I could have, if I had started, if anyone I know started their life in biography or history with Eleanor Roosevelt, I'd tell them, please choose another subject, because you need a few, you just need the faith of knowing that this too shall pass and you will get there. Because there were times I didn't think I would. I really didn't.
You know, I share with you the deriving a real motivation and sense of purpose from the events of 2017. I mean, I arrived in Berlin to work on this book 4 days after we got there. Charlottesville happened. And I went over there just vowing that I wouldn't be making comparisons to Germany in the 30s. It would be irresponsible to do so. Mm-hmm. And then events started to pile up. And then by the time I got back to do the serious writing after we returned following a year, it seemed irresponsible not to draw some of those comparisons because so much more had happened. And you do feel in your small way that you're against the tide, but at least you're rowing, you know, you're engaged in it somehow. And that was very different from the kind of journalism I practiced before. I mean, nothing this personal and certainly nothing this topical, or that spilled, you know, out into so many other parts of the paper, as it were.
I found very beautiful your restraint and your willingness as well to be expose, you know, some of your thinking that would naturally make you vulnerable. I mean, in a world in which doxing goes on and people are, you know, after people all the time for things, I thought you did an incredibly beautiful job of keying up the really difficult aspects of the book for you personally, and not shirking them. And I thought you really came to terms with the truth that you were finding in a way that was honorable. And I wanted to ask you essentially the question in a way you just asked me, which is, was there anything you had to leave out? I don't mean personal, but I mean, was there anywhere you felt as a writer, gosh, I really wish I had been able to keep that in, or were you kind of on track with it?
Well, I've always depended on the kindness of editors to,
yeah, me too,
to alert me. You know, I really leaned on them here, particularly because book length form isn't something that I'm all that familiar with. And I did find great comfort in endnotes. People looking at my book will see that they're attributions, but they're also elaborations. And I mean, not to the David Foster Wallace extent, but I certainly did, I leaned on that. And that there were the times that I was able to stash some stuff that really hurt, darlings that I had to kill off,
yeah,
that I could stash in the endnotes. I felt that I committed an act of subversion, but I kind of smiled at myself and carried on. And I've always had this, it's a terrible flaw in all my journalism, but I would always turn in stories too long. And part of it was I wanted to be the clever kid in the class who raised his hand and said, oh, look what I found, you know?
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Because you and I have had the same experience in archives. I mean, these moments of, you just described the 300 pages about mercury poisoning, but you know, you just want to tell the world, this is interesting, and I found it. The combination of those two things.
Yep.
And I find it interesting. Why wouldn't you? Yeah, yeah, yeah. And
well, I'm back to the box in B floor with everybody else's piece. Look what they found. Oh my God, those guys went all out and got this story. Look at that.
Yes.
And very inspirational.
And this would be a great way to bookend our talk, because you began with a box in B floor, but to me, so much of writing is mimicry. Now, I'm not talking about plagiarism. Mm. I'm talking about reading with an eye toward writing. And I can't tell you how many writers, when they talk to students, say the best way to become a better writer is to read. And what that writing teacher is saying is, it doesn't mean you suppress your own voice. It simply means that there are techniques, there are strategies, there's a sort of confidence on the page. All those things are modeled by tens, hundreds of thousands of other people. And go out and find someone. If they speak to you, incorporate them. And there were people in a class of 79 and 77 and 78 too, because we were sophomores, I think, when we took it, who were riding that horse. I mean, they were really, the wind was in their hair, and wow, you can do that. Well, maybe you can't, but they're doing it and I like it. And you move on from there. And I tell people, it was the course I learned the most in, and it was the course where the professor did the least, you know, sage on a stage stuff.
Right. Although the paradigm of the editor's desk was I think that, I mean, that was the game changer that you didn't have in a creative writing course in those days. You didn't have someone who sat down, at least I didn't have anyone, none of my 185 Nassau professors, George Garrett and Bill Goyen, lovely, wonderful men that they were, and wonderful writers, extraordinary writers, didn't sit down the way Bob Massey did and say, you know, you don't use a comma here. If you do, it's going to do this to the sentence. Do you hear that? Read that sentence aloud for me. No one was at that level in at 185 Nassau. It was all, what are your intentions? And it was just all too much talk in a way. It wasn't actual editing. That you could do that much with a sentence, I was amazed by. And by the way, one thing about Bob Massey I wanted to say was, it's ironic, but I think one of the ways he brought history to life was through people, you get a sense of European history, all European history, through Peter the Great, or you suddenly realize what Sweden was all about through Charles the Fifth, I think it was. His portraits of English, admirals and so forth in some of his sea books. It's extraordinary how he used people to create the world of an entire world of politics. And that's biography, really. I mean, and he is a biographer, although I think he wanted to be known as a historian. And that was the great value of his work was the history. But I really learned the lesson of, wow, you can really make something come alive through a person.
Well, there was a moment in your book that I thought, if there's one thing I took, I would sort of inscribe on a tag and hang around my neck almost, was when Eleanor Roosevelt says that human rights can be propagated when individual people, I'm sure you can cite chapter and verse of it, David, and tell me the exact page it appears on, but when individual people pay attention to the needs and the rights and prerogatives of other individual people. I mean, it's something that we're just crying out for right now in our country, in our world. And it struck me as something that wouldn't have come from your run-of-the-mill politician. I'm not saying FDR was run-of-the-mill in any way. He wasn't. But it took an extraordinary person like her looking at the world in this completely different way to say something like that. And I, you know, that in a doorstop biography that you've written, that I can take one little thing that fits inside a fortune cookie. I mean, that's a great achievement too. So highest recommendation for Eleanor, untitled biography of Eleanor Roosevelt.
Untitled biography of Eleanor Roosevelt. Yeah. Well, thank you. And thank you. And it was the signal thing about her. I think she took Theodore Roosevelt's rugged individualism and focused on the individual and realized that the individual, it's always a balance between the individual and civil liberties. And the world of the nation and what the nation needs. And she always said, start with the individual. You know, the individual is what counts. And I think Franklin Roosevelt learned the same lesson, and it's partly from her. They both shared the romance and value of the people, but really understood that it was about the individual person is where that began, more than just simply the idea of the people.
And I think that's where you can succeed in the United States. As long as you're toggling back and forth between freedom of the individual and unity of the union, and you fit that balance, most Americans instinctively are gonna at least give you a listen. They may not fall on your side of the divide, but they're gonna pay attention. And boy, Eleanor got every day 800 words. She let people know where she stood.
Astonishing, and such beautiful prose too.
Yeah,
wow. Plain prose. Well, there's an entirely other conversation I want to have with you someday personally. And so I'm just bookmarking it because I'm just going to say, you know, just me to you, that next reunion, I want to talk about having German fathers in the great era of Americanism after the war, when my father too was a German refugee, come by way of England. But I began marking up end papers just for myself. And I would put my father's, I would put MM, which was my father's initials, wherever in the margins, I would find your observations about your experience of your father and of your childhood with your father to be in any way similar to mine. So, sometimes it was so similar as to be eerie. I could have not written the beautiful sentence you wrote about, and some of the ways you and your father actually collaborated were different than the way my father and I collaborated on the silences and the not knowing and then the knowing, but which was so beautifully and subtly done. But it was so much my own experience of this not knowing that I just wanted to talk to you about it sometime and say, wow, you really, really went into a difficult, hugely difficult subject and pulled it out. And
well, I can't wait for that conversation. And
fascinating.
Well, it's not a subject I could have gone into much before when I did. So it took a good 40 years, 42 years, I guess we're on, right?
Did you ever think I'm not going to do it? I mean, once you'd started, did you ever sort of think I just can't do this?
You know, I felt when I started to dig into the letters mostly and the diaries, and I just felt I had a responsibility to tell the story. There was just so much rich material, and you know, it's like you know, you're working on a magazine piece and you walk out of an interview and you just realize what's in your notebook, and you're excited. And it, you know, it was all a question of balance and how much it would be about me and, you know, how much I would be willing to make Chronology my friend. But no, I was determined. And I think Charlottesville and being in Berlin and all that happening, you know, gave me a sense of purpose and urgency. So, yeah, let's definitely 45. We'll,
45.
We'll be there for 45,
for
right?
Sure. Yeah.
Right, Bruce?
All right. Well, thank you, guys. You know, first, I think one of the lessons of our talk here is, as a history major myself, I guess I need to do a better job of checking my sources. And I'm sorry I don't have the authority to award you a National Book Award.
It sounded great.
So we'll get back to that. I do have almost on your last points that you made. I do have a question for you, just in terms of, you know, the rich material you had, the eloquence of the letters and the depth that people went into in their diaries, do you think future historians writing about our contemporaries or people now will have the ability to write books that really get to the insights that you guys both did in your books? Because I don't write that way. I don't write letters that way. I mean, I write short emails and things like that. So for both of you.
What do you think, Al?
No, I frequently have thought just, you know, empty cash is just the default setting everybody has. And who's saving anything? I mean, who even keeps a commonplace book? I mean, it's... my heart bleeds for tomorrow's biographers. And, you know, I'd much rather have a case that you did, David, where you have just a surfeit of information and you have to kind of discipline yourself to find the through line than not having enough and where you're just going on guesswork. Talk about fog. But what do you think?
Well, I think I'm not sure exactly because I've not yet done work in this in the world where you're trying to rescue texts digitally, but I think texts are going to be fabulous. I mean, the real-time exchange of information, of nuance, of things, it'll be hard to read. You're going to have to really depend on the historian or biographer or novelist to understand what they're reading, because of course we all know from our own relationships, it's so hard to read texts and read people at what they really meant and what because you don't have the tone or the sound. But man, there's a just gold mine. If those things could be, you know, if they're not deleted permanently somehow, if you could, I would think they will enrich certain things, because just the way, I guess, you know, LBJ phone conversations or JFK phone conversations were as revelatory as Nixon's taped conversations in that sense. If you can see some of the texts in real time, I would guess they'll be valuable. But in terms of expression, yeah, no, I mean, we're gonna definitely be in a new place as far as really, really understanding somebody.
Good. Question on process from Jeffrey Shallett. What tools did you use, paper or software, in order to arrange your research into a coherent narrative?
Wow, that's a, I mean, I'm trying to look. You see what's going on? It's like, no, it's not coherent.
Incoherence is definitely the watchword here. I thought David's chronological bulletin board chart was a great window into what was going on there. I mean, at least it's something. I mean, I do have all the letters my dad sent home to his mother from the front when he was serving in the armed forces of the Third Reich, and the original envelopes, which have postmarks, so I could actually see precisely where he was when. That might be the most organized. Of course, it was my dad whom my sisters and I kiddingly called the human flowchart, who supplied all that by saving it and then translating the letters for us. But yeah, no, it was very haphazard. And I even had to, I'm sure David solved this problem with his first biography, but having never done a project like this, I had to kind of reinvent all the endnotes. You know, I wasn't creating my back matter as I went. I was just so obsessed with, how am I going to tell the story? And
I want to share one thing here, which is, this is one of my obsession, my obsessiveness is, I went back to color coordinated 4x6 cards because at certain points in my, I kept, you know, extensive digital files, of course, and my chronology is actually on digital because everything I learn about her goes into my chronology year by year by year. Then I break out into people files, which also, of course, are arranged chronologically. Chronology is always my friend. Every single thing is file chronology. And here you're just seeing 54, 55. And what is going on here is every single thing I found that I wanted to look at or still from, I would put onto a color. Eleanor's green, Mrs. Roosevelt, SDR, that is to say Franklin's mother is purple because she was born into the purple. Every Roosevelt, every Theodore Roosevelt or grandchild of Eleanor's is red. And yellow was Lorena Hickok, was Tommy Thompson, was certain people, often love interests. And FDR was always blue, just because he was. And so I would put lots of information in by year. I keep it stored. Like, for instance, if I found an article online about Yalta fallout is devastating, it would go onto a blue FDR card with the newspaper it's from, and of course the page number, and there's Drew Pearson writing about Yalta. So that's something I know I want to look at when I'm in 54. It's probably not going to be part of my story, but it's just one of those background things I want to read at the time about Yalta, so I know more. And so I paste it on there, and the house smells of Elmer's, you know, rubber cement in a very happy way to me, but not so much to Nan. But, you know, so there's all these sort of little obsessive things that you do. I also made these, some of Bruce put in it. When I first would go into libraries, I would make these sort of books that were just composition books that kept, like, here is, this is from New York City research. This is research in the New York City Municipal Archives about Anna at Columbia, Alice at Columbia, Arthur Crock's papers at Columbia, Columbia Oral Histories, New York Public Library. So this is a whole New York original. When I would first go and look at sources, I would just keep a kind of simple composition book like this. So there's a certain amount at which you're sort of playing, you know, thesis time. It's like thesis time. That's actually a happy memory for me.
Jeffrey Shallett follows up the question after you've answered it. He says, nice, I even hesitated to suggest index cards because it's so 20th century.
But aren't we? Come on. That's the great thing we've got in 70. Yeah.
There are a couple of follow-ups on the question I asked earlier about Gary Christ asks whether we think social media will be a source that can replace the absent letters for biographers in the future. And he says, sure, everyone's social media presence is highly curated, but maybe the same could be said about diaries and letters. Yeah. And then Kristen Rogers Fisher also says, but you have all the emails and social media posts to go through. I heard someone say the problem is you have so much searchable information that you can support any position you want depending on the search terms you use.
I think that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we're lucky as a generation not to have our, you know, our college life on digitized, basically. I feel lucky not to have my college life digitized, but I'm also aware that when you look at it, it's both incredibly limiting, but also endless. When you look at what's there now.
Yeah.
Kristen also has a couple of comments. One relates to maybe a theme that I think I heard in your discussion earlier. She said, I once heard someone say there are no young historians.
Or architects.
And she also says, I'm impressed that both of you had good editors. I feel like many books I read these days do not have much editorial input. And I don't know if you have a comment, either of you have comments on that.
Oh yeah, I mean, I don't know where I would be. When I turn an early draft in of this book, I refuse to accept Chronology as my friend. I just thought to myself, well, everybody knows the history of the 20th century. I can skip around in it merrily and nobody will get disoriented at all. And I got a very stern what for from editors. But then they reassured me and they said, you know, it's all here. You just need to rearrange it. And for a moment we thought we would cut your manuscript up into strips and just lay them all on a conference room floor and then reassemble them. But then we thought we'd let you do the job. Boy, yes, I got editorial guidance. And at the same time, there are a number of balls in the air chronologically. I've got a main spine, but I've got two different lives sort of being lived in that chronological spine. And then I tack on these little interludes that are set in present day Berlin at the end of more chapters than not. So the reader is getting pulled around a little bit, but I don't think the reader is disoriented. Now, everybody should know that Bruce and his wife listened to both of our books in a cross-country RV ride. So you can tell me whether it worked or not chronologically, whether you got disoriented, but I like to think it did work.
No, I thought it worked very well. I mean, I loved the title of the talk because it really was very, very clear what was going on. It no skipping around. And I thought that was great. As did my wife. I have specifically for David, you know, we kind of get a backdoor history of a lot of other people, as you've already talked about. And I wonder, in doing your research for Eleanor, and given how we are rethinking lots of historical characters today, how do you feel Franklin comes across through your research and your book?
Well, I was just having this conversation with someone who told me for the third time in a few weeks, wow, you're really hard on Franklin. And I was like, wow, I didn't really ever think of it that way. And Alice Mayhew, my editor, actually had sort of not warned me, but she observed. She said, you know, you're going to get some people who are going to be pushing at you about your portrayal, because it's a bit shocking sometimes to see how callous he is. You've emphasized this side of him. And I didn't think I was doing that. But what I did know in my research was that as a student of history myself, and really just as a student, not a writer of history, but I was shocked as a researcher into FDR's life and primarily about one event overall, which of course is now, I think, something that would shock all of us, but his decision-making, the process of decision-making as he decided whether or not to issue the presidential edict that took 100,000 Americans of Japanese origin out of their homes, businesses, and throw them into concentration camps. I mean, we call it, we use the verb intern and internment, but it's concentration camps on American soil. It's American citizens being stripped of civil liberties. And some of the things you see as you just do the most basic research is you see that FDR had commissioned a commission that was run by the then Attorney General of California, Earl Warren, And the commission was to decide whether or not Americans of Japanese origin on the West Coast were a danger to America, to national security, or to other Americans. Conclusively, the report found it was not the Japanese Americans of Japanese, the Nisei and Issei of Japanese origin, who were dangerous. In fact, they were law-abiding, they were patriotic, they were so proud of what they of their businesses and of achievements of their children and so forth. And they were nothing if not deferential to people in a way that unnecessarily deferential to others on their blocks and so forth. The people who were dangerous to Americans were the Americans who had anti-Asian feeling and who were out there with guns and who were armed and who were dangerous and who were desperate and who were angry. And you begin to see everything in that report. And then you listen to the letters and documents that show his attorney general, Francis Biddle's arguments. Mr. President, if you issue this order, there will be future presidents who will use it as a precedent. He did not know that Donald Trump was going to do this to children on the border and separate them from their families and use this as a precedent. He did not know, of course not, but he could see. And why couldn't FDR, and why did FDR ignore reports, advice, so forth, and decide that yes, he was going to do this? So those sorts of things were the awakenings. We're seeing FDR in real time making decisions as president that were egregious and were indefensible. To find evidence where others had recorded him making quite ridiculous and eugenics-based observations and remarks off the record, but then were kept in the record by people at the British Embassy during the war about what you would do to create a new ethnic order in the Pacific, was to see someone like so many of his generation who used ideas from eugenics, had absorbed them either socially or intellectually. FDR actually even, it is a matter of record, put out the word as president to a Smithsonian researcher to find things about the skulls of Javanese and the physiognomy of Indonesians, and actually using the Smithsonian as a tool of eugenics projections and experiments and notions and ideas that would inform his notions about the new world order after the war. Extraordinary. And if you start tumbling into the eugenics world of the 20s and 30s and you see the Harrimans and others putting their money into it, people like FDR following along with it, Theodore Roosevelt urging American mothers, you know, even a half generation earlier, out of fear that we were going to lose following Madison Grant's ideas about the white race being extinct, and all these things that become, as Alex is in Berlin finding, are being used by Hitler in order to create policy for the final solution. All these things are, as you begin to see them, and you begin to see how anti-Asian a feeling and the 1924 Immigration Act and the West Coast's anti-Asian policies are all leading to, of course, Pearl Harbor is going to happen. Of course, there's going to be a Japanese-American conflict. It goes back to Theodore Roosevelt and 1904 when an American steps in and tries to resolve the Russian-Japanese, when the first time the Japanese enter a war against Europeans. So all these things begin to start being clear to you, and you begin to think, wow, you know, FDR, he's the soldier of freedom. He's my hero. How could it be? And yet these are what human beings are when they are in history.
Well, and he also suffers in the comparison to his wife.
Well said.
She's so modern and she's so unwilling to take the bait on a lot of this stuff. And she's not thinking politics first. She's an idealist. And so that's part of the impression. I mean, yeah, he definitely suffers in the comparison, but wouldn't we all?
Yeah. One response to one of our earlier answers, Jeffrey Park adds, present day undergraduates have no idea of 20th century chronology. I read student essays on environmental history that miss the connections to political developments that are simultaneous. Making connections between these new historical topics to the older chronologies is so much more interesting than they know. I don't know if you have any response to that, but that's a point of view that Jeffrey has expressed.
Well, the only thing I'd respond to Jeffrey's point is I have it in the same way that I didn't know about the hunger plan. I'm pretty humbled by this, all of this stuff. And, you know, I concentrated in American history, read David's book, and learned an enormous amount. Now, admittedly, it's sort of the understory of history that Eleanor was engaging with in many ways, and David spends a lot of time on in his biography, but and it was fascinating, but I didn't know a lot of it. And there's no shame in being none too wise to this stuff, as long as we stay curious. I mean, that was my little slogan: be curious, don't be judgmental. And I tried to do that as a way of cutting my ancestors as much slack as I could muster.
There's a lot of compassion in your approach, Alex, and in your book. I mean, it's
thank you.
It's remarkable, and there is so much grace and warmth in those people that to deprive them of that with the overlay of judgment would be too, you know, sad. It wouldn't be them. It wouldn't be real. I felt a lot of things coming through from the people in your book that needed to be there, and that you allowed to let them speak for themselves, which was lovely.
Thanks for saying that. And they did speak for themselves. I mean, and again, I'm so grateful for that. They wrote letters, they kept diaries. They, my Aunt Maria wrote this lengthy anonymous reminiscence about getting reunited with her father and my dad at the Swiss border in 1947. And just to have that raw material to work with was a huge gift.
Yeah.
The, you know, one, a very specific question for you, Alex, is you know, in having all those letters and of course, in retrospect, the poignance of his being well fed on the Russian front versus the what was happening to the Russians. Those letters really were very matter of fact about, I got a lot of food today, things like that. It seemed as though, and maybe this is just my imagination, but it seemed as though after the Battle of the Bulge, and both his descriptions of the Battle of the Bulge and the types of things that he wrote to his mother and others after the Battle of the Bulge seemed far more eloquent. And was that a more formative experience for him, you think, than his experience on the Russian front?
Yeah, I think so, because his experience on the Russian front was not one of adversity. I mean, yeah, as much as there is this association we have with the Russian front as being nothing but adversity, what saved my dad's life really was that he got a study leave before things went south on the Russian front, got back to Munich for 5 months, and then when he was recalled, he was sent west, and he had the mercy of falling into the hands of the Americans and not being sent to a gulag, which would have been his fate. So yes, I think all of us, when we go through hard times, and we try to describe them, we there's more pathos, there's just more emotion. And yeah, he's fat and sassy, almost literally, early in the war when everything's going swimmingly for the Nazis. And I think you're right on the money there with that observation.
Kristen has a question. Kristen Rogers Fisher again has a question. Are there things you wanted to hide but decided to include anyhow? And I think that's probably good for both of you.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely wanted to hide, in a sense, the levels at which Eleanor had to shed anti-Semitic, sort of social anti-Semitism. I don't think in her heart she ever hated a Jew in her life, to be honest. And then her incredible discomfort as the child of American Southerners, having learned to treat Blacks as servants, and to do a reasonable job thereof, but still as others, as people who she was not ever going to really understand, but then to begin to start recognizing that she did need to evolve out of that and begin to understand beyond just simply political calculation or political advancement, begin to understand even more why she was resistant or why she was accepting. And she did. She kept moving forward, but so slowly sometimes, and slow walking certain things, and having responses that were very difficult. Or to see her, I would find her in Joe Lash's diary, you know, yet again, as late as 1942, telling a dialect joke, an Amos and Andy style dialect joke, and using the dialect joke, partly ironically, but also because that's how white people told jokes to each other in 1942. And I kept a careful kind of catalog almost of micro acts of racism around the Roosevelts that I was just seeing in the record, so that I could kind of put some of the things that I was seeing Eleanor was doing in context, so that, as Alex just pointed out, I wouldn't be judgmental. I would merely be curious to see, what are these people, why are they acting this way? Why are they treating the people who they actually care for in some ways very poorly, and or just simply as others? And the racism was pervasive, and it continued on through the Truman administration, even though advances were made. But I felt always, oh God, I just don't want to get stuck where the reader has to get stuck and the story has to stop, because we now have to acknowledge that this really was terrible. Yeah. And so I would always try to figure out a way of taking a story of yet one more. In fact, it was the fact that even as recently as a year ago, the United States Senate was considering the notion of, did our country support lynching? Literally a year ago, 2019, on the floor of the US Senate, Rand Paul, Senator Kamala Harris, having opinions about Americans, about the US government's policy on lynching. But every time it came up in the 30s, I would wince again, that I would have to explain to the reader that we were no farther down the road, and Eleanor was no farther advanced in her ability at this point to make things happen or whatever. So that was on race, and it was on religion that I found to be the ones that most affected me.
Yeah, I think I didn't want to hide anything, but there were many times I just wanted to look away. You know, I didn't want to know. I mean, it was this struggle between wanting to know, because that's why I embarked on the project, and then not wanting to know, because that's just, it was my father, it was his mother, it was my great uncle who was a member of the SS. And you can't undo any of it. But I just felt there was, I have kids, and I wanted to leave a record for them, you know, an accounting for them. And I felt that, not that my dad had been remiss in not telling me everything, because I understand why he had a particular attitude as a new American, and with a 50 sort of laying out like a golden road before him after he'd had this ridiculously difficult time up to age 27 to get his life going. I just felt that I had this bounty of material. I'd reached a point in my professional life where I had the time and the resources, and it was just the times were calling. You know, what was going on in the world was making the case to do it. So, the only instinct I had was, gee, I wish that hadn't happened. I wish my dad hadn't eaten quite so well in the Ukraine, mm-hmm. while the hunger plan was being enacted, for instance.
There's a new book out now by Luc Menand about the Cold War, culture in the Cold War. And in it, he says, getting into the United States after the war was like getting into a highly selective college. And the reason that resonated for me when I was thinking about your book, Alex, and about my own father, was that one of the things you can do in a highly selective college is you can become a new person. You can use the resources of the college to build a person, but build a part of yourself that wasn't there before or wasn't allowed to be there before. And it was one of the ways I began to understand my own father's uninterest in telling the truth, was that it was all part of this incredible opportunity of America had after the war of newness, of building something new.
Oh, and I discovered that, and my dad had a very similar experience. You know, his dad had become an American citizen as an exile, so he wires it so my dad can go to Princeton as a grad student in chemistry. And that's partly because, and no German citizens were getting out of there because there was no German government to issue passports at the time. So I completely identify with that. And in the course of my research, I discovered that my step-grandmother, Helen Wolff, invented these parts of her biography because she wanted to ease their way as immigrants. So anybody asked, she said she was born in Skopje in Macedonia, not in Serbia, because Serbia was considered a less privileged or probative way, place to be born in. And they pretended that they lived in a fancy apartment, posed for a publicity photo in an apartment that wasn't theirs. So there was a lot of this reinvention going on, but people did it because they wanted to be part of the 50s and make their way in the new America.
My father, given the circumstance, would let the person asking the question about the name Michaelis leave with the impression that it was Greek and not German. And his inability actually, or his unwillingness to accept that he was in any way attached to Germany was breathtaking to me as I grew up, but that's another story. I was struck often in your book by the Princeton of it all, that how early your connection to Princeton began and how it was part of your family life and part of the story. It was fascinating.
Yeah, and it's so funny because the connection, unlike so many of my classmates who were legacies who had a connection because of their WASPy bloodlines, it was entirely because of the exile community that Princeton became a part of my family's life, because Albert Einstein had the mortgage on the house on Evelyn Place off Nassau Street where Erich Kahler, this emigre from Vienna, lived, who worked with him at the Institute for Advanced Study. And my dad, as a grad student, was able to get an upstairs bedroom bathroom suite, which he lived in. And that started the whole Princeton thing. And when my dad would come and visit me when I was an undergrad, there would be John Nash riding his bicycle around campus, a beautiful mind. And my dad remembered him when he was living in the graduate college, riding a bicycle around the basement, whistling the Ode to Joy from Beethoven's Fifth. So I felt that there was this Princeton, it's a perfect note to strike on a reunions video, but there was indeed this Princeton thing, but it was a kind of subversive one, if that could be said.
Yeah. On that note, I think we should probably say thank you for being so generous with your time and for such a wonderful opening for our 42nd reunion. We are getting old.